The panel is on minorities and the media, and I'll read a brief para on it. Through a study of mainstream and more intimate media practices, the panel reflects on the visibility, invisibility of bodies and voices on the margins. In the deeply contested domain of representational politics, the panel collectively reflects on the idea of marginality and minorities through still and moving images. Our first panelist is Suhail Akbar, and he's going to talk about Muslim women, modernity, and making of the photographic image. Islam has always had a contentious relationship to image making and iconography, and yet, as this representation will attempt to show, Muslim women and men have frequently forged an intimate relationship with the camera and use it as a diary, memoir, and archive. In this representation, Suhail Akbar attempts to explore this relationship through his mother's passionate relationship to photography, through which she recorded her own life in the mid-20th century. Suhail Akbar is an associate professor at JJK-MCRC-JMI, where he teaches analog and digital still photography. He is both an academic and a practitioner with a special interest in popular forms of photography, including family photographs. Akbar makes short films and translates stories from Urdu to English. So I hand over to Suhail so that he can start his presentations. We will try and keep to our timing between 7 and 10 minutes.
Thank you so much, Sabina, for introducing me. As you can see, the topic of my presentation is Muslim women, modernity, and the making of a photographic image. I'm a photography teacher. I will also, to save time, read what I'm wanting to say, and you will see some interesting pictures from my mother's archives. Even though most of us in the subcontinent have grown up arguing about the contentious relationship of image making with Islam, I, through this presentation, shall argue that wherever there was a will, there was a way to counter this view, be it Sufi Islam, where shrines have been a major repository of image circulation, or at more personal level, where photography defied any diktat against human image making. Talking about the latter, this was because humans nursed the desire to be captured in their true likeness ever since this new technology of photography arrived. Also, photography allowed one to transcend their normal self and be catapulted into the realm of fantasy and frolic. Let us see a small clip from a much acclaimed documentary film, City of Photos, where you see a mother and daughter duo so besotted by the idea of being photographed that on camera they decry the patriarchal norm of their family, where the male members call photography a sin. It's a very short clip that I'll play, and it's a Muslim family in Gujarat, Ahmedabad, and from this film, where
you know. तो स्टूडियो पे तो जाऊँ, ऐसा मेरे को बहुत सोचना पड़ता है। कहीं हमारी जमात में भी शादी होगा ना, तो मैं कहीं वीडियो कैमरा लगा ना, उसके आगे आगे पहले आऊँगी। तो बोलते ही हसीना को तो बहुत सोच गया, मैंने कहा मेरे को बहुत सोच गया। मेरे भाई लोग बहुत नाराज होते हैं कि भाई गुना है गुना, मैं क्या तू चुप जा, तू तेरी कबर में तेरे को सोना, मेरी कबर में मेरे को सोना, तू तेरा देख मैं ऐसा बोला है ना।
So this is an interesting clip from I move forward. I open this presentation with an image taken most probably in 1931. India was still a British potentate, and life here was still predominantly in the throes of a feudal agrarian order. The Muslim gentry that had been out of power for the last 80 years, after having ruled in the Indian subcontinent for more than 600 years, was still coming to terms with the emerging Western modernity that had in many ways crushed its arrogance and superiority at the hands of technology and mercantile trade. Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan, the leader of Muslim reform, had argued that if Muslims wanted to progress and be like what they had been in the past, they will have to embrace Western modernity, its scientific rational thinking and education. A major response to this thought of Sir Sayyid was the establishment of the MAO College, which later came to be known as Aligarh Muslim University. Sayyid Bashiruddin, seated here on the left of the lady wearing a tie, was the product of this thinking. Placed here in center, he was a professor at the AMU when this photograph was taken. The blurred haze in the front is his daughter Rehana, shaken most probably by the fidgety behavior as an infant in front of the camera that may have required a relatively long exposure to make the image. Camera came into young Rehana's life rather early, as she was constantly photographed at home and amongst friends and relatives in both the organized as well as the candid manner. Aligarh, a small town and provincial university in North India, was known for its university, where her father taught. Social contact was amongst people of the university. Needless to say that it was primarily a Muslim community, and contact with non-Muslims was negligible. Or one can say the dominant non-Muslim contact was with European teachers who taught at AMU. They brought about a sense of sartorial modernity to Professor Bashiruddin and his children, who seemed dressed rather fashionably in these photographs. The other dress that Rehana wears is the traditional Muslim long skirt called the Garara. Friends too, who were fond to face the camera, appear in this traditional attire. The Islamic encounter with modernity, of which the camera was one of the modern tools, had started taking place in its early days of arrival in Delhi, where its most enlightened citizen, the great poet Mirza Ghalib, is said to have dragged himself a few days before his death in 1869 to Delhi's earliest photo studio and got his portrait made, which we know as an iconic image today. Moving back, thanks to her father, Rehana's engagement with photography as a child and young student made her comfortable with the presence of the camera. Posing in front of it was a regular affair, both at home and in the studio. Soon, she graduated from school and got admission at the medical college in Delhi. The year was 1949. India was a new nation, was brimming with confidence and looking forward to be self-ruled under the able leadership of a modern leader like Jawaharlal Nehru. As a reward to have made it to a prestigious course, she was gifted a camera by her father. The camera became a visual diary for Rehana. As we see in her pictures, the visible effects of life in a cosmopolitan city came very visible. New friendships were forged that bring a multicultural flavor to her life. Her best friend for life now becomes a girl from Gujarat. These days she recalls how she was taken aback when he met her in those days by her vegetarianism. Another person is a Parsi lady from Bombay. This brings changes to her own lifestyle, which one notices through her own documentation. She starts wearing a sari as well as a bindi. You can see it in the top photographs in the center there she is. And a bindi is basically primarily a Hindu symbol which is worn, but I mean she accepts these multicultural these norms. Scholars always mention the role of camera in recording leisure and travel. Friends meet and love to be photographed. Pets and newly acquired cars are put on display as accompaniments of modern life. Picnics out of the city are a norm as a relaxation on the day off work for these young doctors. Dabbling into its formal essence, photography itself is explored. Light, shade, balance, other aesthetic norms that dictate this art form are naturally imbibed and executed. Higher medical studies take Rehana to England and are an important opportunity for her to frame the world through her camera. Visits to museums, fairs open the mind to Western sensibilities. We again see a detailed documentation of day-to-day life. New friends are made, and of course travel through the European continent is very much a part of the camera practice. Here I want to make a small, as much as I keep referring and looking back to these photos, I must do a minor transgression here and share a thought that seared my mind lately when I was writing this paper, and it brought to my mind the recent Burkini debate. In all photographs, her mother and her friends from India that were with her in Europe wear only the sari. Not a single person adorns a Western attire. I'm forced to wonder what they thought about abandoning the sari for European clothes then, and that what were their reasons for resisting any such change. I mean, this was just a thought that I thought I'd share with you. Later on, she returns from England. Camera as a constant companion on return continues to unravel life at its many life milestones. Marriage leads to the creation of family. Children are photographed with frenzy. And the ritual is consolidated by making the photo album that has captured many nuances of her children's life. Their growing up and the process, and in this process, memorialize the family. So, once again, the primary visual communication technology of the time is handled by a professional woman who defies stereotypes of gender and religion. She turns the notion of image making as sin in Islam on its head and leaves us with a brilliant collection to look and study. Now, Dr. Rehana Bashir is now 87 years old. She lives a retired life in Allahabad and enjoys looking at her own photography very often. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sohail. And I'm also working, my name is Sabina Kidwai. I'm working as associate professor at Jamia. And my presentation largely looks at the Mumbai attack of 2611. You see, before I actually go into the attack itself, I'd like to talk to you, I'd like to just give a brief about the way television, and it so happens that from a very personal narrative, we now move into the mainstream and we talk about a terror attack which happened in Bombay, or which is known in India as Mumbai, during 2611. And I look at the coverage of that, of the entire event, and also talk about its impact which it could have had, it happens on the way we look at minorities, especially the Muslims. You know, the important thing which is to realize that television news has a particular pattern which it has developed, and especially in the period between 2007 right up to 2008, there is a particular build-up which happens. So when the Bombay attack happens in 2008, we realize that there is already a existing history which has already been built, because throughout 2007 we find there have been a series of attacks by which often the person who is behind the attack has been identified as a Muslim, and a group has emerged which is called the Indian Mujahideen. So already we have a history, and we have already looked at the young Muslim man as the aggressor, and he is already, in popular perception, is also considered to be the main enemy. And also the form of, you see, television news at that particular point of time of 2007 and 8 is also going through this phase that we have newly discovered the whole idea of 24/7 news and of breaking news. So I'm quoting from a person who's done work on surveillance and witnessing, a person called John Oxford. The uncomfortable truth is that television journalists, especially with their attraction for the visually exciting and the dramatic, is inevitably attracted to scenes that create spectatorship, a fact that the media-savvy terrorists of the 21st century knows full well. This was graphically demonstrated by the endless repetition of the Twin Towers image in the weeks that followed 9/11. Such images failed to function as surveillance, since no new information was supplied in the repetition. Nor could they be justified easily in terms of witnessing, since the moment of history had been experienced and had passed. Yet the visual stimulation of spectatorship remained and could be re-experienced in all its fascination and terror with each repetition. The important thing is why I'm quoting 9/11 is because 9/11, as we look at many of these visuals, 9/11 when the Mumbai attack of 2611 happened, it was constantly being referred to India's 9/11. And it was also a way of connecting the two. So constantly all your news reports said that this is India's 9/11. And therefore, indirectly also suggesting that we should take action. So it also launches what we call India's war against terror at that particular point of time. Liveness of news today is a key shaper in the relationship between television and terror. It is this which conveys to us the immediacy of the event and makes us a part of the ongoing tragedy, almost making us a witness to the event, but also mediating the event for us. 24/7 telecasts with breaking news also creates the anxiety for constant news. Today, the easiest thing to create a negative image of is radicalism. It is both popular and riveting for audiences of 24/7 channels. This gets particularly significant when you're dealing with an ordinary marginalized minority community. The other thing which is important to realize is that in this period of prior to 2008, when the attack actually happens, in the entire period of 2007 and all, we also find that we are dealing with a situation where prior to every terror attack, there is always a video release of it, there is an email release of it. So it's almost like the channels also, you know, there are things which the channels have become much more aware of today. But in that particular period of 2 years, we find that the channels almost felt that it was their exclusive property that an organization or a terrorist organization has contacted them, we must propagate the email. So it became like, it was almost like that they were providing information before the attack and while the attack was happening. So another thing which was happening was that this was something which allowed negativity to grow beyond the attack also. There was a tragedy of the attack, but the prior information which came also allowed you to build your opinion about who has done the attack, why have they done the attack, and who is to be blamed. So this actually became the basis for many of the media reports which followed before and after the Bombay attack. It was also found that what television did was that when you actually went to report a particular situation which happened in the case of the Mumbai attack, we find that they allowed, you see, when you are running when the major thing of the attack was that it was like a 24-hour coverage. You know, so it ran, it's supposed to run for about 60 hours. And the channels and their cameramen were there throughout. Now the story and that period also had to be filled in. What was the only visual which was available was the visual you had of the dome burning, which became symbolic of the attack. But also you had to fill it with investigations, stories, ideas. So what most channels did was that they actually created histories from their own archives. So they decided that, you know, this particular group could have done it, and this particular group did this attack. You know, so they created their own histories, which allowed you to decide that a particular community or a particular person was responsible for the attack. So even, when we actually get to know about the identity of the attackers a little later, but this information starts from the point at which the attack happens. And that is what leads you to, so that when even information which comes out, which could be contrary to what you have believed, it doesn't actually get reported. Because by then the channels have already built up an entire history for you. They've already told you that it is going to be the Lashkar-e-Taiba which is responsible, it is the Pakistan ISI, it is also could have, and also the more dangerous part is that they decide that the Indian Muslim must have been somewhere involved. And therefore, the entire support which was given for the attack was given by an Indian Muslim. Now, the interesting part is that nobody tries to even find out that it could be anybody. That's not important. What is important is that it has to be a Muslim. And a young Muslim who has given the support. Now, connected with all this is also that throughout 2007, we find that there have been these, there has been the Butler House encounter, which happens in Jamia. Prior to that, there has been the arrest of people from the Simi. There have also been the attacks which have happened in the lawyer's court. All that gets somewhere connected because you already have an enemy in place. So therefore, this attack has to be somewhere have the backing of the young Indian Muslim men. So that keeps getting reflected throughout the coverage. The other thing which happens with it is that, you see, the past starts controlling the future, controlling what how you represent. The other thing which happens is that all of them have these titles which says War on Mumbai, War Zone Mumbai, and India's 9/11, which is also triggering of India's war on terror. And it is also allowing for another debate to surface, and that is of nationalism. So you find that the channels run these entire programs, which is like NDTV runs a program called In Memory, and this one runs a program which is called The War on Terror, which is run at that particular point of time. India Today was headlines today. Now, what did these programs do? These were large campaigns. You see, they not only happened in the studio, but they also happened outside in the candlelight marches, in the debates, in the discussions. And NDTV's campaign was largely around the feature film industry, around Hindi feature films. And right from the 60s till current, they got well-known singers to come on stage and sing nationalistic songs, which actually were very beautiful songs, and some of them we have all grown up with, but they had a very clear context. They were talking about India uniting today in terms of this crisis and uniting against an enemy. Now, the point is that what emerges much later is what they identify as Pakistan or the Pakistani ISI. But in the initial phases, when these programs happen, the enemy is somebody who is a person who can only be identified one way, and that he is a Muslim. He's young. Now, whether he's Pakistani or Indian remains a little bit of a debate initially, but he is definitely young and he's Muslim. So these are two issues which keep coming up. And in the entire NDTV campaign, we find that it is very emotional. You get very moved, and you know, but they're all songs, all the songs are about the nation and about the need to protect the nation. Headlines Today, on the other hand, my time is getting over, just 2 minutes more. In Headlines Today runs a campaign, War on Terror, which is far more aggressive, which says that you as individuals must come out and fight against terror and therefore identify the enemy. Now, this whole identification of the enemy is another issue which was very important in the whole previous year, because you find that in most of the campaigns which were run earlier by the channels, they had all talked about, they had shown you these visuals of people who were supposed to be suspected in the attack. And every time they would tell you, go out in the street, try and recognize this person, try and catch the big person. So the same thing gets repeated in the War on Terror campaign. Also, the other point was that along with these campaigns, they also ran talk shows, discussions everywhere, where there was another thing which started to happen was, now why I'm connecting this so clearly with what is happening just before the attack is, there were a lot of, these questions which are run by television shows. Do you believe this or do you not believe this? I'll just take one more minute. Do you believe this or you believe in, do you think that, that in fact, even CNN, IBN ran a campaign where they talked about the fact that are you scared? Do you fear terrorism? Do you fear Muslims? So all this is already been done. So when this attack happens and after this, it becomes almost mandatory from people, Muslim people from all walks of life and prominent people to come forward and say, we believe in the Indian nation. And anybody who didn't, who had any other contrary opinion in, you know, in terms of nationalism, actually get shunted out of the talk show. So I have recordings which indicate, which show you very clearly that they are not allowed to speak. And I remember one thing of Imtiaz Ahmed, who actually said that, why do I need to have to come on screen and prove to you that I believe in the nation and I'm against terror? He actually gets shut, he's been shut by the anchor. So this is a kind of thing which happened, and it allowed the Muslim minority to become more and more, allowed the prejudice to go to a great extent, and we can see signs of it. You know, we went through a phase where we felt that things had improved as far as the television channels are concerned, but we can gradually see we are going back to that phase. It takes very little, it takes actually only an attack to start suspecting the internal minority community. Okay, I think I'll stop here, I shouldn't. Okay, and I'd like to introduce you Dr. Kusuma. And Dr. Kusuma is a senior assistant professor at AJK-MCRC-JMI, where he teaches communication theory and research, performance media, and a course in South Indian cinema. Kusuma researches on several media-related fields, and one of his areas of primary specialization is Dalit and minority studies. Kusuma is going to talk about Indian cinema, tracing the trajectories through Bombay and regional cinemas. Caste is a vital category for social inquiry of Indian society, as it affects every sphere of life, overtly or covertly. Cinema, from production to public distribution, embodies a process in which caste is imbricated at every stage. Yet caste in cinema remains a much under-discussed today, part of a larger body of work that focuses in large measure on the cinemas of South India. This presentation explores the challenges confronting the representational politics of Dalits in cinema. Kusuma, come.
Thank you, Dr. Sabina. Coming last is an advantage because most of the points will be might have discussed, but still, I will be speaking on caste in Indian cinema with respect to Bombay and South Indian cinema. As we all know, caste is more discussed and visible and more accepted reality in every sphere of life today. So caste system is a very maybe unique or peculiar feature of Indian society. Unlike the other social systems, like race, it's always been dynamic and taking different shapes and positions according to the existing situations, from rural to urban, urban to mega-urban. Their presence is very dynamic and it's only taking a different shape without undergoing any structural transformation to accommodate people from the socially deprived caste, especially with respect to the Dalits in particular. Dalits, needless to add, are sociologically neglected and deprived of formal education, art, literature, and to some of from the mainstream society. Cinema is a creative industries which are far away from their cup of tea. So here, I would like to make certain points for maybe discussion. Hindi cinema, before I talk about the representation of the caste as well as Dalits, there are two different things in the Indian cinema. It is important to talk about the industry itself. If you see, the neo castes, after the Jamindari system, the landlords with huge acres of lands and the rice mill owners, they have started migrating and to Hyderabad and investing, or in Chennai, investing in cinema industry. They are majorly from the, not from the so-called upper caste, which you say Brahmins, but is a new dominant caste, which are strong in political sphere as well as the money-wise. The Reddy, Kamma, Kap, if you see. That is one of the important thing I wanted to bring to this panel, that the industry itself is driven by a few castes. So there are, it is astonishing to know that there are very few, I mean to say that maybe 0.001% of actors in lead roles, and directors you can't even imagine. But there are actors who are coming up in Tamil industry and in Malayalam compared to these other Kannada and Telugu industry. S.V. Srinivas, in one of the article in Moving Image, what he says, cinema is a public institution. It's a democratic space. But I slightly differ, agreed with the point that, see, if you see message barriers, tracing the history of Tamil and the South Indian cinema, Theodore Bhaskaran talks about the touring talkages. Okay, every towns are not able to afford a cinema hall. These are in the bullet carts and whatever the means they have, the cinema used to travel to different places. So in this, coming of a cinema theater has opened up a public place, but it is not democratic. It has different classes, balcony, bench and floor. Initially they are made of sand, later they are sand. So here it gave an access if you have a money. The class creates a caste. So here the instances, the many atrocities took place in the cinema halls. One is Guntur district of Andhra Pradesh, where there are 20 Dalits have been massacred after Dalits have started sitting in balcony halls. And the same, the Warner kids, they were also there, and there is a spat, and after that they have been lynched and packed in sacks of sacks, and they're thrown in different places. So here there are many, many instances like that. So here the other issues are the what Professor Shobhini rightly talked about is the fans association, which is a unique feature. Though there are fans association in the cinema, in South it's almost like a religious activity. Like what Bhrugupanda says, fan bhaktas, I mean cine devotees. So in this, for example, one of the Ford Foundation study, first study on Telugu cinema, we can say, by the CSCS Bangalore, which is also slightly part of it. Many barber shops started keeping Kamal Haasan photos because Kamal Haasan acted as a barber. In the same way, I wanted to say that many of these fans associations are actually they follow the what the lead actor or the star caste is. I mean to say that either Kamma or Kapu, and there's, even this just last week only there is a fight between Kamma and Kapu, fans associations, and fans rituals are also very interesting to see. They even give blood donation, even they give food, do a lot of other activities. Here, I would like to tell you that how do you see Dalits as an audience toward an upper caste hero? Okay? So where do they fit in? Where do they have their own associations? It's an interesting point. Sometimes they identify with the characters, like Prabhudeva suddenly dancing in front of a dead body procession. He is playing the tappu, which is associated with one of the Chamar community who makes, who deals with the dead animal skin. So they identify more. Suddenly there is a fans association of Prabhudeva. So here, I will say put an end to my detailed introduction of the industry. If you look at Hindi cinema, Franz Joosten's 1935 Vachit Kanya, similarly Bala Yogini in Tamil and Telugu 1938, again Achyut Kanya, which is actually translated as the Untouchable Girl. These films, mainly they tried to, and after that Sujata came, same in Telugu also came, 1965, around that time. These are very benevolent, very shy, and it's a kind of a reformist movies which is trying to give a new life to the people. And in fact, in Achyut Kanya, they travel to Kolkata and they're kind of a disguised identity kind of thing. But here, in the early movies, till 50s, you can say, these movies, the Dalit woman, if you see, very benevolent, somebody should come, and maybe the aspiration of Dalit woman to become the Hindu fold is always shown, which she may or may not want actually. Finally a negotiation is done that okay, you are accepted because you helped my mother giving blood or something, saving people. It's a kind of thing. In 90s, one of the groundbreaking movie came, 1997, Osei Ramulamma, a naxalite. Generally in the Naxalite movement also, there are a number of groups, there is a lot of casteism. In that, a Naxalite group is headed by a Dalit woman who is cheated by her husband, who sold her in one of the remote places of Telangana. Then she joins the Naxalite, and she started helping the people. So that brought a new Dalit woman in terms of a bold with a gun. I mean to say that that movie has brought many people, from remote villages. People used to come to the cinema halls and they used to stay outside and they used to cook outside and they watch again and again. I mean to say that this Dasan Narayan Rao. And what I want to tell you is that there is a journey of Dalit women or Dalit characters, if you see. In the 70s and the early 80s, there is a strong impact of left movement or maybe Naxalism on cinema. Not Naxalism, I can also say trade unions. Okay, there are movies made on trade unions which are fighting against the owners of the companies. What Tejaswini Ranjana says, her work on Vijay Shanti, is a Naxalite cinema. But I say in local language, we call it as a red cinema. Era cinema. It's a red cinema where the caste is shown as a class. Caste is not at all a problem. But there is a mention of caste, but the solution is a class. Here, what I would like to say that the new movies which have come in 80s and 90s, like for example, the hero is a rowdy, maybe fighting against the state, and all these movies are also having the issues of caste. But the point is, the new devotional movies which has come up with the local Dalit gods become a big hit. I mean to say that, like previously N.T. Ramarao, Sri Krishna Vijayam, or other mainstream gods. Suddenly Ammur, which is a non-veg god, maybe very much into the very weird scenes, I mean to say that a lot of crime or maybe violent scenes of God emerging and other things, with the new special effects. This has also brought up Dalit issues in a different way, the devotional cinema. So here, finally I would like to tell you that there are some movies which won national awards, state awards, by filmmakers like K. Vishwanath. They are treated as a class movies, whereas movies with fights, six fights and six songs and a final climax which is a hero fights and saves and the police deep comes, that's all actually mass movies. The class movies which are attempted to try to revive the the Bharatanatyam or Kuchipudi or the song tradition, they adopt a Dalit boy or a girl and they try to train them, and they have a competition against the other fellows in the Agrahara. See, in this, finally, what I want to tell you that the entire movie is from Fran Josten's Achyut Kanya till today, either Ammooru or the recent, the marriage is one of the important thing, which is even you can say Ambedkar has founded intercaste marriage, which has intercaste marriage, temple entry, atrocities. These have been repeated themes. The marriage is one, the director slips from the what he tries to say, more progressive when it comes to the marriage. That's where the exact, treatment of the movie ends, with the popular acceptance. They either kill or they try to, have some kind of a... The last point I wanted to make is, I just wanted to add, in the entire movies, there is a movie came in 1978 called Karunamayidu. That is the first movie of all our Hindu gods and goddesses. The Karunamayidu, which is made by the local actors, unknown actors, not N.T. Ramarao, not Krishna, Nagarjuna, this Karunamayidu, first Christian movie, which has shown across the villages by the Christian missionaries and all, and the Christ started speaking in Telugu, has become very, very, very popular. That's one of the place, maybe I feel a lot of Dalits have also converted and started accepting, realizing, and that is there. But having said that, another point I wanted to say to conclude, my points are scattered. The ongoing, there is a subcaste movement, there are other identity movements. The cinema did not pick up as they are there actually. Somehow I mean to say that. There are some references here and there, but there is no straight references. But whereas Tamil cinema recently, either Kabali or Madras last year, there is even Hindi cinema, Masan and Gudu Rangila, they are coming up with the themes. Maybe filmmaking has become more cheaper and the releasing is possible. So there is a hope for a Dalit cinema in the lines of black cinema, which is more organized, more hopeful, more stronger against the white cinema. Maybe. Thank you.
We have limited time. We have basically another 5 minutes or so. If there is any questions, if anybody has any questions, please. We'll take 3-4 questions and then we'll,
Yeah, my name is Syed. I come from Chennai. I am basically a television journalist, and I observed your and I listened to your presentation on this terrorist attack. I feel that there are three particularly landmarks on the television journalism vis-a-vis terrorism. One was the Kandahar hijacking. That was, I think, in 98 or 99, I don't remember. I was reporting those events. And the second was the major which you covered. And the last one was the latest, this Zakir Naik debate. Mm. And you can gauge the media's mood, which is basically centric, Delhi-centric, and it tried to portray things according to within Oates' quoted vision. So actually what worries me actually most is mostly a comment. I can't frame a question here, because I closely covered that Kandahar event, which was hijacking from Kathmandu and then went to Kandahar. So there were a lot of Muslims which came on the streets of Delhi, and the camera people were interviewing them, and they were saying that I am very paranoid and all. In fact, some of the representation had gone to Vajpayee also. I mean, that time he was the Prime Minister of India. That you tell me whatever I can do, I can do. I can go and get the people. Then the media was totally, you know, in disarray. What they want to take a national stand or they want to take an anti-national stand. And in fact, at one point of time, I was watching that those events very clearly. The media was trying to convey that an anti-national stand, saying that India is not doing anything and things like that. So then probably I was told, I mean, in fact, I don't have any source of information, that the government came in between and they told media to shut up and don't try to portray anti-India movement. And probably my feeling after that is that whenever this kind of attack is coming, the media takes a very shelled, I mean, kind of a importance, and nationalism takes, I mean, surpasses all other things, and it's basically national centric. And in that they create the other enemy in terms of whoever it is. So I just don't know. I mean, if you like to comment, you can comment. I mean, this was the thought which I gathered.
A few more questions? Yeah.
My name is Kamal Siddiqui. I'm a journalist from Pakistan. When you showed the slides about the attack in Mumbai, I saw a lot of similarity between that and how 9/11 itself was covered in terms of identifying who would be behind it. I don't know whether a study has been done, but what were the things that were not similar between the two?
Okay. Anybody else? Any other questions?
You know, I thank you all the three for excellent presentation. You know, as far as the first presentation was concerned, though you confined to photography only, you know, it is a fact that image making is not new in Islam. Right from the initial days, there has been such kind of processes. I have little knowledge, in spite of being Muslim, about Islam, as far as these things are concerned. But I have a feeling, whatever I have read about Islam, that, you know, with the change of time, changes can be made. Say, for example, while you are in the air in a plane, if the namaz time is there, where is the west side? So you can go for any side for offering prayer. So photography came also much later, and the hadith itself says that, well, like-minded people who know Islam well, who are sympathizers of Islam, can sit together and decide about it. So even in Mughals, paintings, even good painters were Muslims. Even before that, there was a history of good painting, sketching images. Even the scholars, right from the beginning, have been using human images for presenting their ideas. So the hadith says that avoid it, but to be very frank, like music, like singing, people say that music is prohibited in Islam. But the fact remains that right from the Prophet Muhammad days, there have been singing, there have been music, and many scholars, Islamic scholars, said that, well, you can practice music, but in a limited way, that it should not get vulgar. So similarly, if the photography doesn't depict any vulgarity, I am of the view that there is nothing wrong in that. As far as the Dr. Sabina Kidwai's presentation regarding terrorist attack is concerned, you know, I have a feeling that more in-depth reading regarding behavior of channel is required, because channel is no more an objective entity, it is a corporate body, it is business driven, it is started with a specific interest, whether political, business or selfish interest. So the owner decides what is to be projected and what not to be projected. The books during Gujarat riot, which came, they clearly said that, you know, that time it was the new phenomena, and this kind of incident has taken place for the first time in the country, a large massacre. So they did not know what to do, but they realized that the kind of images they had thrown up on the television, it enhanced that communal issue, not only in Gujarat, but also throughout the country. So probably the professional, when I talk to the professional, I have been in television on the national channel. When you talk to the professional, there is no problem as such, but the kind of dictate they get from the owners, the kind of dictate they get from the political masters, there lies the problem. So probably, if you can talk about that something, if that has been the part of your research, that would be interesting.
Okay, anybody else? Shoini,
you want to? No, I just want to thank everybody for very nice presentations. And I had one question for Kusuma. What do you think about Devar Magan and its Hindi remake, Virasat?
Okay, we'll start with Kusuma first, then we'll go backwards, huh? So Kusuma, you can answer Shoini.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, the films like Devar Magan, Naikaru, Interim is Naikaru. Many films which the titles itself says that it is Narasimha Naidu, or you know, the cast names are our cinema names, unlike in Hindi. So here, the upper caste, the good, it's always a fight between one bad so-called upper caste person and a good upper caste person. They help Dalits in, maybe they are working in the farms and other things. They try and become a solution to the issue, but not Dalits as a solution to the issue of their own identity. This is one thing which has been in films of N.T. Ramarao's son and grandson, and even other actors who are becoming, even the Suryavamsham is also a similar kind of thing, which is shown, even Chandramukhi, so these is a kind of, at one point of time, like that the K. Vishwanath movies, where they will try to Brahminize and accept, but these kind of movies, a wealthy upper caste person wanted to become the hero of the film or a savior, or that it's a kind, I see it as a, again, reinforcing in a different way. There's a politically, some they are shown as factionist leaders, some they are shown as a, in this film, like, you know, the political leaders. The issue remains the same. They're only Dalit audience and upper caste heroes in, till now. Maybe I hope I could be able to answer that.
Suhail, what did you
No, I agree with Dr. Mithipal, what you said. Yes, I mean, my idea of presentation was, and I started by saying that it has always been, I mean, the desire to be photographed has, so as a human desire, has always been there, and in any art form has been a manifestation, and it has kind of been transgressive, or it has found its way, even in Islam or another religion. I mean, there I have seen a mosque in Delhi which has parrots and monkeys, which was early the Sultanate period, this thing. So iconography or making of images is, human image was a bit of a debate area, and I myself had experiences as a photographer when I, in my family also, when I pointed a camera at somebody who said, no, please don't take my image. So that is a contested this thing. I mean, I'm just trying to show that, yes, I mean, there was a person who was in 30, I mean, the camera was, people were comfortable and people have always, I mean, as you saw, I mean, it's a different class of a person when you saw in that documentary in, from Ahmedabad, where the lady, they say, you apni cover within his own soya. So photography has always been an interesting space for people who have desire to be photographed, and they manage their ways. Similarly with music, and all. Nothing personal. Thank you.
Actually, I know that the Mumbai attack is highly, it's a much larger debate, which I've tried to put down in 10 minutes. And there are many more issues which it raises, which we can't possibly discuss, you know, quickly. And it is true that the reportage, when you look at 9/11 and you look at the attack, you find there's a lot of similarities. And it's also very similar in the way it defines enemies. But it is also more significant because you have to look at what happens before and after the attack. That's a very important thing to see, because only when you look at the way the channels looked at the issue prior to the attack, It was almost like that the attack was waiting to happen. So when it happened, for the channels, it was almost like we were telling you it was going to happen. We were already pre-warning you. We were already telling you that you have to be careful. And then, you know, then when they go about the process of actually pinning down as to who is the enemy. And we always find in India, we always find a very easy solution that when we can't really define what has happened, we blame it on the external enemy, which is Pakistan, and which definitely is also Muslim. So everything starts getting clubbed there. So the Bombay attack is something which we can't, you know, it's difficult to debate. And I know there are many opinions around it. And there are also issues of nationalism which got raised. And also when the issue of nationalism comes back, comes in any crisis, it becomes very difficult to look at other perspectives. So, I mean, I don't know whether there's even time for us to get into that discussion just now. I think we need to close it.